A very warm welcome back to you and welcome to live coverage from the Philippines and Manila of the Manila Major. It is the third major, of course, of the season. We're headed towards the international next. $9 million already in the pot for the amazing international later on in the year. But we're focused on Manila, of course, today. Day one of nine. The main event, of course, in 2 days' time. We're going to have a break after the group stage. Today we're focusing on Group A and Group B. And we've had a refresh on the panel. So let me introduce you to our three erstwhile colleagues. We have Nahaz back on the panel for the first time here at Manila Major. Welcome. We also have Toby One, who has done a little bit of commentary this morning as well. I think a little bit. Okay. Empire-y stuff. And also, Fogged, welcome back as well. Good to have you back. You had a good time this morning. Yeah, it was good fun.
Round two.
These guys are going to get into the game fairly quickly. We're already into the draft. So we will get your thoughts as we go through. But we'll bring the draft up as we go along. There's a couple of bands already so far. Nahaz, we'll start with you. Interesting that we've got these two teams in particular in the lower brackets, right? Mm-hmm. It's lucky in many ways that this isn't elimination time for these two teams and that all of them carry on to the lower bracket regardless of whether they go out now. But did you really expect Wings and Secret to be in the lower bracket game?
Secret, I think, was kind of the high variance team coming into the tournament. A lot of people wondering which version of that team would show up. They definitely had some communication problems in the last couple of events. Wings, though, yeah, I think everybody, a lot of people had Wings top six, if not top four, expected them to have a fairly easy time in this group. And yeah, to see them come out and drop their first series was a major surprise.
Toby, thoughts?
I wasn't actually expecting Team Secret to do that well. I got to watch them on very closely during Epicenter, and a lot of the time it was this... you knew there was a lot of dis-synergy within the team, and I didn't know if they could repair it in time for the Manila Major. I wasn't backing them that much, but Wings, I did not expect them to be in this position. I actually had Wings up there in my top four, top five for this competition.
I think almost everyone.
I think all of us did.
Yeah,
we did.
And the fact is that as we go into the draft now, Bounty's first pick, that's a new one so far here. We haven't had that so many times. We saw a little bit last time out at Epicenter, but it has been a popular pick in this particular patch. Because they did so well last time they were here in Manila, a lot of people were saying, well, they're going back home, they're in Manila again, they'll have that vibe, they'll remember how they won, and they should be really hot. And we know how they can play, albeit kind of some strange stuff with supports being put in mid and stuff going in the jungle that you don't expect, but we know how good they are, and yet here they are in the lower bracket.
Yeah, definitely shocking to see Wings here, but... maybe they went a little bit too outside the box with what they were trying to do, and
I mean, they won
got punished from it.
They won that game.
They did win that game. That is a good point. But.
They did win that game. Okay, Darkseer is Secret's first pick. So no major surprises so far.
Where's the Phoenix?
Apart from the Phoenix, potentially. Yeah.
Well, I like the fact, though, that Wings have gone in a different direction with the Bounty Hunter, and they really are. They're looking to punish that very greedy style that Secret plays, where they're trying to farm up two cores very, very heavily, relying on Universe to create a lot of space. I like the Bounty Hunter open. The Nightstalker pick, I'm a little bit dubious on. Death's Hero has really struggled. He's kind of near the bottom in our Elo shift ratings by hero. Hasn't had a lot of success in the offlane role, though Newbie ran him very effectively earlier today.
I think maybe that's kind of like a deterring, like a counter pick toward the Bounty Hunter, even though,
probably a four here, actually, of course, with the Darkseer.
Yeah, and also maybe, I think the Darkseer also kind of may have been a counter pick as well, because, you know, the Bounty Hunter Darkseer, I think Wings is one of the teams that has ran it before, and it Darkseer is one of their popular offlaners. And now we do see the Lifesteer picked up quite early. We haven't been seeing him too much.
No,
it's been a Chinese staple, though, recently. Like, the Lifesteal or Lion Open is kind of the standard open for a lot of these squads, including Newbie. But I'm not surprised that Wings would pair it with the BH.
And it's also, you know, it's a hero that can tolerate the Ion Shell, of course, because you can either Rage or you just attack the creep really quickly, and, you know, Feast works really well against it.
Still, question for you, though. We saw in at least a couple of the games earlier a Lifestealer really suffer early on. It was actually Resolution's Lifestealer that suffered really badly early on in lane against a Darkseer, because, of course, you can Rage to prevent some of that damage, but you can't really use Rage to farm the lane against Ion Shell.
As long as they have, like, you need a support there. You know, you need to at least have... I think Wings is usually recognizes that, too. They emphasize on securing the short lane, so I think that they will probably have, like, either the Bounty Hunter start there or maybe one of the other supports, if not even, have a tri-lane committed, because Secret could run that dual aggro tri-lane, which we do see happen quite often, if they don't opt to go for the Iron Talon jungle puppy. What's up, Toby?
How you doing, buddy?
What's up, man?
Hi.
How you doing, Toby?
I'm doing great. I'm doing fantastic. I want to see more of this draft actually unveil.
Did you enjoy the Drow game earlier?
I actually did. I did. There was a lot of enjoyment behind that one. I always like it when a drow's able to come out on top. And thank you very much, Red.
I'm glad
you can keep the stereotypes going right now. Like, if you really want to do it, we're red versus blue right now.
We actually are red versus blue right now. That does work as well. Yeah.
Yeah, and we were around when that series was created. Unlike
kinda
these.
Kinda like
okay.
It's like pastely red and blue over there. I don't know what's going on.
I should have smelled that one coming from a mile away.
Mm-hmm. Love you, Nahas. Oh.
So what do you make of the draft so far, Tubby?
Nothing really surprising for me. Like, to see Team Secret pick up the Night Stalker, it's the same kind of thing the Puppy wanted to achieve with his 4-position Beastmaster before. It's just this kind of, like, presence on the lane, but you know you're going to have a vision advantage more than anything else. So, like, Night Stalker will be great with that. Good, you know, man. Your Darkseer is going to be stable on the lane. You've seen issues with Team Secret so far with their drafts. They want to have something really simple. If they can get that Night Stalker to a point where he can reach his Aghanim Scepter, might be difficult when the Bounty Hunter's there. Means I'm looking more towards the 4-minute rotations coming out from Secret. Who works with the Night Stalker? What's that secondary support? How does he actually find the kills and make the most of that first nighttime phase, if he can?
Mm-hmm. How difficult is it, Fogged, for Secret to ban here against Wings?
I like this, though. They're taking an approach where they take the Darkseer, they take the Night Stalker, they ban the other two offlaners that Wings really likes, the Tidehunter and the Beastmaster, so they're kind of limiting that offlane a lot for Wings, because that's pretty much
everything
that they do. It really looks like it.
It does, doesn't it?
Because the only ones that they're missing is what? Batrider offlane, Furion, and...
And maybe they're not scared of the
Broodmother? I don't know. Something like that?
Not completely out of the question that this will be a Midnight Stalker either. The Dragon Knight ban right after you've picked the Night Stalker is a little bit interesting to me in that regard.
But that's also, that's a Wings hero. They love Dragon Knight. I mean, they love a million heroes, so that's kind of...
It's kind of hard to say.
So the Phoenix is going to come out second phase. No, we haven't necessarily seen that too often, but it's back again.
That's really
unexpected. Do you think that's a mistake from Wings, or do you think they wouldn't have expected it?
Maybe they
A mistake from Secret, or...?
No, a mistake from Wings, in terms of not banning
second phase. Oh, not banning second phase. Yeah.
They intentionally... They picked the Bounty Hunter first. They kind of just left it there, so maybe they feel like it can get punished quite heavily.
Yeah. And we've seen Nyx against it today.
Yes, we have.
Yeah, we have.
And that was amazing performance.
Yes. Very effective.
Amazing performance.
Yeah. And it's funny, actually, because I think we saw a couple of Nyx against it at Epicenter, but it wasn't really played the same way as it was played earlier today.
Yeah, and it was the big difference there, right, is that I believe all of those matchups that I saw were a support Nyx or an offlane at best. It didn't get very much. Yeah. And it makes a big difference that the Nyx was overleveled in that game.
Wings have never picked it, but I would not put it past them picking a Nyx. Like, it's extremely good versus Phoenix. I guess it's not really the best versus the Night Stalker, but it's great. It's decent versus Darkseer as well. You know, later on in the game, Mana Burn can be quite obnoxious, and Carapace on the Ion Shells.
And you got that Night Stalker mid just sitting in my head right now.
I really...
Because, like, how is Secret meant to lane this? Do you actually run a Phoenix and a Night Stalker both supports? Can you get away with that, Fogged?
It's not the most optimal,
it seems odd to do.
Yeah. Well, Secret has pulled some weird stuff out in this tournament. Yeah. Like, the last series, they had some really interesting stuff that they did as well.
I mean, I think
the Kunkka,
what we've learned in the last couple of months is that you can run a lot of support combinations if you have a good scripted set of early game rotations that you run with them. Mm. Right? If you really have a great set of rotations that are going to put pressure on the opposing lanes, you know, you can make a lot of support duos work.
But with this lineup, like, you're almost running it differently. Like, you're pushing it so you run the Night Stalker and the Phoenix into a farm kind of role. Like, you protect your safe lane, you find more D push than anything else and create space. Then, like, you just prioritize vision so you know where the Bounty Hunter is moving so he doesn't screw you when you're inside your jungle as well. Because is this just like, you can just run a straight Iron Talon Night Stalker and a Phoenix back babysitting the mid or the top lane.
This is such a Wings draft.
Your laners have to be so strong.
This is such a Wings draft.
What is that? Just Wings things. Wings.
No, they really like the Wings. They really do like the second phase Slardar. I've seen them third pick Slardar in a couple games already, and it's just sort of a glue hero for their drafts. It gives them that AoE disable, gives them that way to amplify the physical damage done by the Lifestealer, gives them the vision advantage to go with the Bounty Hunter.
They may still have problems with the Phoenix, however, like, because now you're running like three melee heroes up against that Nova.
Exactly what I was about to say. Really good point. That's perfect, dude. No, that's actually perfect. But Slardar does give them as well an option for that Roshan, gives them a little bit more of objective based. Mm. But yeah, three melee heroes running into the Phoenix can be a little bit difficult, especially because you're versus Darkseer as well.
Especially when you're blind for the last two heroes coming out of Team Secret. You're not 100% certain who you're up against here. Because if it is just going to be that mid and the safe laner, like, what do you even get? Now you also know there's like a slot or a lifestealer. We go for more AoE control from the puck.
So not the Nightstalker mid. Yeah. I didn't really believe in it too much.
It didn't feel right. Mm-hmm.
Got a lot of lockdown. They are kind of lacking physical damage heavily on Secret, though. It's all pretty much magical damage at this point.
Yeah, this is feeling more and more like a single core strategy from Secret, and that's just so risky against Wings.
It depends on the core. Like, it depends who you get up against. Like, if you actually can play Ember with vision advantage here, that's where my mind first goes here. Speak of the devil, Wings is going to pick it up. You'd be able to like dodge Slaughter's initiation. The Lifestealer couldn't control you at all. Like, that would have been a great way to go, but instead, Wings, they have the Ember Spirit now.
That's it's a vehicle for the Lifestealer if they want to use it like that, which is probably something we don't really see at all. But
it wouldn't be a bad combo. Catch puck out at the right time.
Yeah, definitely catching the puck out because, of course, you can't phase shift during the Searing Chains. So that's a really interesting pick for them, just to pretty much countering the puck. And I think Ember Spirit's quite good versus Phoenix. You can get into that back line really easily.
Mm-hmm. I'm wondering how now Team Secret round up their lineup. Because we're still looking for the EE hero. Unless EE, surprising us all, would take Nightstalker, which would probably surprise us all. How does he battle up against Ember, Slaughter, and Lifestealer? You're still running now a 4 melee lineup from Wings.
And then they're going to pick Ricky last, right?
Oh, my God.
Double infiz, mess with the puck as much as possible.
That would be the sickest thing.
Can you imagine that?
It's like you got no Monkey King Bar heroes as well.
I don't even disgusting.
EE can bring up his PA because like there's no MKB heroes.
But look at this. It's a measure of how...
Disgusting.
It's a measure of how confident Wings feel.
Wait, did they not ban? They didn't ban.
Why did they not ban?
Mind games. This is a wing strategy.
They're just like, we don't care.
Wing strat.
It's either it that or they maybe just ran out of time and this can screw up all your stats now.
Guys. We don't care. We've got this.
Look at what they've done here. Picking an Ember into a Nightstalker, a Puck, a Darkseer. They don't care.
They don't care at all.
They genuinely don't care.
Do they Visage here?
Hello?
No, okay. They go for Disruptor. So that's pretty much first. Yep. That's pretty appropriate. Yeah, it's very good versus Darkseer, very good versus Puck and Phoenix.
Okay. It doesn't give him really like a lot of gank potential on most of the lanes, however. Like it feels like a real passive kind of thing. Like you can counter it and maybe you can glimpse him back if you've got the vision advantage, but like how do you rotate down to the bot lane and help Lifestealer get a kill against if like Phoenix is down there or Darkseer surges away, you have to have the vision to get the glimpse. Or the levels to get the glimpse.
Yeah. I like that though, the amp plus the glimpse. That's cool. Mm-hmm. It's a
that'll work.
Nice little cheeky combo.
Amp and track plus glimpse.
Map and track, yeah.
Yeah.
That'll give you a vision.
Nice and cheeky. But okay.
So we were talking about the fact that he didn't have anything like that. Perfect pick, potentially.
Yeah, I like it. He can kind of be left alone. So that we were talking about, is the Phoenix, the best, being like kind of like the solo support, you could say. And he can kind of get left alone, but yeah.
Okay. Just before we go over to the commentators, very quickly, based on the draft, I'm going to give you the opportunity to predict the entire series. Go, Alan.
Predict the entire series?
Based on this one draft.
Yeah, because you get the draft. Normally you have to do this before the draft. Quickly, go.
I'm going to take Wings here.
Okay.
I'm actually saying Wings, but 2-1.
Okay.
Up against Secret.
All right.
I'm going to go Secret.
Okay.
I'm believing in them.
2 for Wings, 1 for Secret. We gave them a little bit of a chance that time round. Let's head back to the commentary desk for game one of game three.
Our loser matchup in group number B. Letter B. Anyway, this matchup between Team Secret and Wings, obviously a lot of hopes riding on both sides. Which one of these two teams is going to end up bottom of their group? Like we're about to see. Game kicks off.
Wings Gaming versus Team Secret. Who will be victorious?
Who will win the knife round? Who?
Oh, sorry.
Oh, man.
Sorry,
I can't wait to get game, out of here. All right, guys. It's Capitalists and Gods. What's your bets, Gods? We see this draft. I like Wings. I mean, I like Wings a lot here. They were a favorite team of a lot of people here, and I like this draft from them quite a bit.
Yeah, there's a few heroes which when I see Wings get, I'm just like, okay, they're in their comfort zone. But they've also been losing with some of those. Like the Alchemist Venus, I'm like, I thought they were really going to win that game earlier today. They're going to lose it. Bounty Hunter to me is another similar pick. When I see Wings running Bounty Hunter, they just in their zone. Like, that to me is where they're going to be able to just control the tempo of the game, dominate the early game laning stage, and really catch teams off guard.
All right, well, Secret already starting things off right. They surprise Wings with a four-man down to bottom lane. Of obviously, with the Ion Shell, it's tough to actually contest that, so Wings don't even try. And in the process, Lardar was unable to pick up the top bounty rune that was being contested by Eternal Heavy. And he also took a lot of damage in return as EE just went for the spin.
Yeah, so double bounty rune, not as big as it once was with the experience changes, but still going to give a little bit of an early edge to Team Secret, specifically Arteezy in this mid lane, who is going to be playing the Puck versus Ember 1v1 matchup.
Yeah, this is going to be one of the matchups to really look out for, as well as that bottom lane where we're going to see Universe and Puppy pair up together as an aggro dual lane with the Nightstalker and Darkseer trying to put pressure on the Lifestealer as early as possible. This is one of the things I like this about the draft, is that it abuses the Bounty Hunter pick quite a bit. It just means you know they're not going to have a very strong safe lane, even though, yeah, Lifestealer is probably one of the better carries to match up against this. It still has an opportunity to work for Secret.
Yeah, it forces this response, which is Bounty Hunter going to be coming towards the bottom lane to effectively trial lane against the dual lane, but this is just where Secret have to adjust, make sure they don't overextend in this 3v2 setup, and try and deny as much XP as early on as possible, which they're trying to do through this pull camp.
This also means that the Slaughter is going to be matched up against dual lane of his own. Small little glimpse back, trying to get close enough to be able to get some damage on the Puppy, but he is rather tanky and he's decently fast too, so not really a problem for Secret there. The Phoenix, though, with the Juggernaut, unfortunately, they don't have a hard disable, so Slardar should also do pretty well.
He went for the one level two bash.
If he gets another bash, this is crazy. Looks like he's just straight up got the kill with a slow. Oh, the dive! It came just a little bit too late. He finally got that level two, but half a second too late. Pylai die will be your first blood.
I mean, that's Wings in a nutshell. They just do this crazy, bonkers shit that you just don't expect. Suddenly, a slider right-clicks you, and it's like a second-hit bash or something at level two. You're just like, as Pylai die there, is probably just like scratching his head, like, what just happened?
I didn't expect that one, that's for sure. Especially, like, as against the Juggernaut, the spin, they have no disable. You naturally think, oh, he's going to have sprint because he just wants to be able to get out of range of the spin, and he can play this lane really aggressively. But no. Well, let's play this even more aggressively, apparently, as Slaughter is able to pick up the first kill of the game. Now we're now going to have our Bounty Hunter trying to rotate into the middle lane. There's preemptively a counter ward left in place by Arteezy, but it's on the far right side here, and it's going to take a lot of damage.
He may just get solo killed, though.
The chains does go out. The Sunray's coming in, trying to heal him up. Arteezy just barely phase shifted that one, but the Shuriken in the end will be able to finish him off. It looks like with the dive, they'll get the counter kill, but still really important that the Ember Spirit is able to kill Artur there and reset this lane.
Yeah, the aggressive orb just allowing himself to... The Shuriken in the end needed to get the kill, but if Ember didn't kind of miss Micro's here, it wouldn't have been needed at all, so... Bit of a mistake there from Puck, who is going for an early double null build, so going for this very aggressive early game laning build, but not paying off at all.
Yeah, Arteezy really trying to punish the Ember Spirit as much as possible, but obviously that rebounds pretty heavily back onto him. The Bounty Rune picked up by Phoenix as he heads back up to the top lane, try and keep that Slardar under control, but it's just really not going to happen. You can see Slardar is already level 4 and does finally have a level of sprint as well as boots, so shouldn't really be much of an issue.
Yeah, with the start that Slardar's had, he should be able to contest this lane pretty well.
Oh, nice crush, managing to catch Pylai die as well. He'll take a lot of Sunray damage, but this also means Pylai die is going to be dropping a bit low. The synergy gods, Sunray plus healing ward.
Yeah. That's the way to go. I was looking at these two heroes, and I'm like, there isn't really much synergy there. You haven't got any kind of setup from Jug to Sunray hero down, but
yeah.
I guess, like you say, you just spam that Sunray, heal him back up. Envy often goes for more points in the healing ward than a lot of Jug players.
And minute 4, Puppy thinks he can get aggressive and ice, and he might actually be right even against the Bounty Hunter who showed up. They get the glimpse back onto Universe, but they now have the Ion Shell Shuriken. Oh! Ever so barely that's enough to be able to finish him off. The Shuriken plus the right-click hit of Shadow Walk. Bounty Hunter is able to finish off the Night Stalker just in time.
That's unfortunate for Puppy, and that's the start of the night as well, so he's dead at the very start. He can immediately head back out to the lanes, but that's at least maybe a quarter of this nighttime phase wasted, so bit of a hurt to Secret's early game. And this is not that jungle farming Nightstalker. This is just a level 3 Nightstalker who has been dual laning, only has 5 CS, so it's not like he can look to... He wants to get something done in this first night, even if it's just like a bit of pressure and harass here and there.
Yeah, but unfortunately without the silence, that's going to be even more difficult as he's just level 3. He's going to try and wrap around on mid, or maybe head up to the top lane.
Yeah, they caught vision of the bounty hunter, so they know Innocence is up here.
So maybe a better opportunity to try and sneak the kill mid. If he rotates top, he'll just be scouted out by the bounty hunter either way.
Yeah,
he does have dust, though. If he catches the dust at the right time, he could solo kill the bounty hunter maybe, but obviously we know that's not going to happen.
Yeah, and Blink's going to hit level 6 in this mid lane on his Ember Spirit. So the initiation potential is there. If Arteezy uses his orb, he may just get initiated on by Blink, and that's just going to be a straight-up kill here. Disruptor nearby as well, so Arteezy has to play this very carefully.
Maybe the right kind of glimpse. It is only level 1. He went for the extra level of Thunderstrike, I think, in a fight. They get real quick damage on Artur. He doesn't actually immediately pop the orb, but I think he was hoping to try and bait that one out. So when Artur comes back into lane, maybe the orb is on cooldown for a few seconds, but not the case here. Teezy holds on to it. The bounty rune, or the runes in general, going to be covered here by Wings. They're going to be able to pick up the bounty at top lane, regen, raiding at bottom lane.
It's definitely not great news that Secret have to spend this entire first nighttime playing passively, but at least they are getting good farm in two of the lanes with the Puck and the Juggernaut. The Darkseer is getting a bit out of the offlane plus the jungle, so it's not all bad news for them, but it's a much slower pace than we've come to expect from that four position Nightstalker. Normally it's 4 minutes in, roam around the map. You play that like that super bounty hunter almost.
And I do think that this, in fact, this is something that Charlie and I were discussing last night over dinner. The fact that we really feel like Secret, in order to succeed, have to be able to put Artur in that space-creating role, right? He can't just be more of a farmer because, you know, universes can't always be able to create all the space in the world for two different cores that are greedy as hell. So Arteezy actually playing the Puck, I think, sets Secret up for at least better opportunities than we saw in the previous series.
Yeah, and it's a hero that is also somewhat self-sufficient, at least has a way to get away from ganks, so you're not like, it's not like the supports have to commit a ton of time to babysitting him in the mid lane, making sure he has a good time.
Yeah, we can actually see that rotation coming out now. Is Secret going to move both of their supports from top to bottom? And looks like they will manage to catch Ice Ice. He's going to try and dip through the trees here, going to be attempting to run down by Universe on the Darkseer, but it's not good enough. Clean escape there, and rotation failed.
Okay, mid lane looked like there was a bit of an attempted poke from Innocence, but not even getting any damage out onto Arteezy, who has a regen rune. So very static lanes right now for Wings especially, outside of the Bounty Hunter, who is that kind of roaming hero. But we're not going to see a TP just yet or any kind of big move from Shadow on the Lifestealer, who's probably the big one who can make that first play should Secret go for a dive. I think that's where he's waiting for some over-aggression out of someone like Puppy on the Nightstalker.
Yeah, exactly. Especially since your offlaner is a Slardar. His timing, he peaks really, really high when he has that Blink Dagger, right? And they could have some great combos. But until then, if he really wants to get active as the Lifestealer and use some sort of Infest Bomb, it's probably going to have to be on the Ember Spirit. I think in general, it's just Wings are going to be happy just sitting things out and biding their time, just trying to get to that 15-minute marker where I think they'll hit really strong. Arteezy coming in with the invade. He's going to look for the coil. Will be able to catch Ice Ice. Free kill there, but unfortunately, the nature of the Lifestealer makes him too tough to gank.
Yeah, just a quick pick. Not something they can transition into a tower, so not too meaningful for Secret. But it is daytime, so this is kind of the farming stage of the game for them. The one thing I don't like for Wings is something I saw in an early game with Faith Bian on the offlane for them. The Slaughter doesn't go for the Iron Talon, and I think he misses out on at least some farm because of this. There was an earlier game as well where he played Beastmaster. He went for the Quelling Blade, was jungling a little bit with his Bora, but he never actually upgrades it to Iron Talon. It's such a good item. It gives you a bit of armor, and there's really no reason not to get it.
Didn't see this one coming, the Infest into the Bounty Hunter. Forgot there was that option as well. So they may just be able to catch out the Juggernaut. It's going to need to be led with a Slytherin Crush most likely. Otherwise, Eternal Envy is just going to be able to spin and probably run himself away.
Yeah, they know he's there amped up, but the amp will get immediately dispelled by a Blade Fury. So going to try punish Puppy's jungle, and that's actually perhaps the much safer, reliable play to make.
Yeah. Very smart. I mean, they know Puppy's going to be jungling. They get this free kill. They can start putting some pressure on the top lane or maybe mid from there. So Wings, 4-2 now. as they poke out with their safe lane carry, and this also gives the opportunity for Disruptor, and that's another reason, right? You could say that Wings are very likely to play a lot more static in their laning phase. They've got a support there at the bottom lane that needs his level 6, so some space being bought there, but it looks like it's going to be punished almost immediately.
And at some point, they also want to get the Bounty Hunters level 6. It's where the Tomb of Experience being added did effectively give a small buff to some of these heroes like Bounty Hunter who roam around.
Ice Ice, he throws down his ultimate, managed to catch the Static Storm a little bit on RTZ, but he's actually drawing a lot of damage and may still be able to get out of here. The orb actually lands on him. The Silence finish him off. RTZ is now left with no escape mechanism except for the Surge that comes in just in time for Universe. So clean escape there, forced to TP rotation, but in the end, Wings' cores are still looking pretty decent. They're all behind the Juggernaut and the Puck, but not by much.
Yeah, and when we see the Slider Blink Dagger coming online, that's where there will be those first smoke rotations. The Ember Script may wait for his boot to travel, so he might try to sit in a lane or tell his Slider, like, go find a kill or two without me, go with Shadow on the Lifestealer, and then I'll join up later with boot to travel, but Wings will very much up the tempo as soon as that Blink is online with Bounty Hunter's track as well.
And would you say like Wings is kind of like that 15-minute aggression is one of their signature styles that they're most effective at?
Absolutely. That's often if they don't have like a really big laning stage advantage and they've drafted around like getting a bit of an edge out of the Bounty Hunter, but Bounty Hunter is one of those heroes where you're not reliant on the early game going well. You have that kind of plan B, which is wait till that around 15 minutes, you get track up, you start playing aggressive, you get kills, and you snowball out of control.
So this could be kind of the bread and butter of Wings, and with that Bounty Hunter, they should be able to have that extra bit of oomph to all of their ganks and really be able to build themselves a serious lead. And that means this is also the most critical period of time for Secret to make sure that they don't get run over. It's also nighttime as well, so they're going to try for it. They've got a really long nighttime. They just pop the darkness. It's going to go to the 12-minute mark and go full dark for Wings.
This poor Disruptor. Every single time these ganks come his way. He's even gone Trenkle's Windlace for that extra movement speed. This could backfire a lot for Bounty Hunter if he's not careful.
It really could with all this smoke. They are going to bring the Ember Spirit down, and they may actually be able to pincer. Oh, no, the dive away. Pilot Dive managed to get the Supernova, but immediately the pop out the Rage, and they will be able to take out the Supernova immediately. Support for support. Now they manage to get the Night Stalker as well, and Innocence will be able to get away. Universe pops the Surge and runs himself out, but I think this Ember Spirit, especially with that beautiful Blink Ford from Faithman, will be able to catch out too. Eternal Envy's also going to fall as they just get right-clicked down by Shadow. Four down from Secret. Make it potentially five as Arteezy is going to try and jump back to his orb, but now the Slaughter is going to be able to blink forward, catching him out, manage to get the bash as well. A full wipe at 12 and a half minutes in. You couldn't have set it up any better. We said Wings, 15-minute aggression around that period of time. That's what they're best at, and we see it right there.
They were just ready to go. The pieces just fell into place. They only had three heroes down there initially, but they were ready for that Secret movement down bottom. Something that it felt like Na'Vi took advantage of as well, just Secret perhaps going for these two predictable rotations. It's 12 minutes in, second night phase is there. You know the Puck with his newly picked up Veil wants to fight, wants to go for some aggression. Same for Puppy. He doesn't want to just sit in the jungle. He's already gotten very little out of the first night stage. It's the second one. He wants to go fight, and that lane ward bottom, yeah, it doesn't see the smoked up heroes behind, but when Universe is a solo Darkseid pushing past that ward deep near the tower, you kind of know something's a bit fishy. You're wondering, like, why is this Darkseid pushed up to our tower with no backup whatsoever when we've got Ember, Bounty, Disruptor, all these great heroes to catch him.
And Wings, not going to let up on the brakes one bit. The smoke, oh no, he just went for the blind blink in, knowing that the smoke was popped. Doesn't get anything just yet, as it looks like Wings are going to be successfully rebuffed by Secret. Ice may actually be caught out. Oh, I like this play. Vian actually moves over, managed to catch the Puppy Night Stalker, slowing him down with the open wounds. We'll be able to get that track kill as well. That simultaneously got themselves a pickoff, a track kill, and also kind of protected Ice Ice. If they all just retreated downriver, it might have been the Disruptor would have been the last one out and an easy pickoff for Secret instead.
Yeah, so they get Bounty's Arcane Boots off of this, and this is such a dangerous stage of the game. And that's with it being nighttime. It only gets worse as soon as we reach that next day, and Wings have such good pickoff potential. The Disruptor pickup with the Slaughter and Bounty Hunter when you have tracked and amped heroes means if you commit to a fight as Secret, you can't disengage. You are fully committed. So you have to make sure any team fight you have you have your entire team there, and you don't, and you get the perfect initiation. Because as soon as things go badly, Wings will win. Like, they'll get a team wipe. That's what we saw at bottom. It's either all or nothing with Team Secret when you're versing a draft like this.
Oh, did he catch him? He managed to get the dust on him. The tracker is going to give him some extra movement speed. The rest of the team is close by. Two-man stun. Starting things off for the Slaw Dark. Double Shuriken as well. The track kills are potentially there for Wings if they could just get the rest of the team into that secret shop. The lockdown puppy. Get that one kill. The orb comes on through. And now the Omni Slash. Bring Shadow a bit low. Looking for that infest out. 5 more seconds till that's up. Doesn't look like he's going to be able to make the escape. Faith Bian can only do so much to be able to stall that kill. Meanwhile, the Ember Spear does have to jump away. Shouldn't be an issue there. Jumps over behind the mid tier 1 tower, at least where it was, and TP's out successfully.
Yeah, good commitment from Secret. Once they know the bounty's there, they just caught him with the dust. They commit everything. They make sure Envy's coming into the fight. They have Arteezy there as well, ready to go. And there's no half measures when you're versing Wings. So Wings perhaps bite off a bit more than they can chew at this stage, but that's not going to throw them off. If you're Wings, I think you just go, yeah, you go right back at Secret, and they're smoking before Lifestealer even respawns. He's not going to be here. He hasn't got a global TP.
This is very likely to catch Secret totally unawares. The double damage on Slardar, and even if they run into a support because they have a Bounty Hunter, this all becomes well worth it unless, oh no, the Glimpse back should still be able to catch him, as I don't think Pileidae can actually get off a Supernova. That would have obviously still meant his death. So he holds on to that cooldown. Wings do get the pickoff. It is a track kill as well, which makes it all the more successful.
Yeah, this is an okay stage just to chew through smokes to find track kills, because it gives you such a good gold boost, gets you towards that mech on the Bounty Hunter. And for Wings, it's very much all-out aggression. And they can keep on doing this. They want to also fight before Arteezy gets the Blink Dagger where possible, so we'll see how much more they can do. Now that it's daytime once again, I imagine they're going to be looking to use this Bounty Hunter to try scout out even more pickups.
Yeah, that is one of the things about this new build on the puck. It does offer some better times going, 25 minutes. You actually hit really hard. You have all this mobility. But in this weird period of time where you have the Veil but you don't have the Blink, it's actually something that teams may be able to take advantage of now. Obviously, we saw earlier, they spotted out that ward placement from the Bounty Hunter, but it's top lane where Secret may be trapped like rats. Puppy does not have a TP out, and he's going to start Iron Taloning his way out to freedom.
Teams are just getting so much better at using scans. We see a scan onto the tier 2, basically trying to see, okay, is someone either retreating from the tier 1 or coming to back up to defend this tower? And they did get vision of something, so Innocence is already trying to see exactly what they saw, and Puppy may get caught out as a result.
Yeah, he sees it. The sprint is activated. Slaughter is going to be able to catch up in another track kill and maybe a forced TP. That's actually going to be completed by Arteezy. He thinks he's going to be able to get the Bounty Hunter, but
I think Phoenix is dust.
Vision? Yeah, I'm sure it's going to be coming in. Ward laid out, but it's a little bit too late. Now the rest of Wings are going to be able to jump in. Pileidae take it out before the Supernova, and that's big, even as the orb comes through from Arteezy, and he does a lot of damage. He's now left stranded underneath this tier 2 tower as Wings surrounding, hoping to be able to take out this mid player, and it shouldn't really be an issue. Chain stun, and with that amp damage, with the Lifestealer as well, who's got an armlet, as well as an Echo Saber already, the damage is too much for Arteezy to be able to work. And now Eternal Envy might actually be taking too much as he goes for a spin.
He went greedy for the tower, like, okay, I'm going to Blade Fury the tower. It gets denied, and then on top of that, Shadow's like, oh, I also got your kill. So this is, just a tilt, more than anything. Yeah. Secret just got 2-0'd by Na'Vi. They're going to go into the next series, and this is the kind of drop which will, really just mentally challenge you as well, because it's so aggressive. You give up a couple kills, you know it's track money, and you know they're going to just keep coming at you and continue to fight. So if you're not playing, perfect polished Dota, this draft will get 1 kill a minute, and we're almost at that point for Wings.
Ever since that bottom fight, Secret have always been on the back foot, and I don't think they were ever really in a position to be able to five-man and fight Wings ever again, because you just know even if you kind of do okay in that fight, you're going to trade off track kills. So now it's just left, okay, try and push this game a little bit later, which is Secret. Something that Secret usually like to be able to do, but they don't even have the Battle Fury yet on Juggernaut, which means he's just inevitably going to fall way too far behind.
I don't think they've got the late game to really fall back on either, with a Dux. They've got the team fight in the late game, but they haven't got the carries to scale in the late game.
Yeah,
Nightstalker's
exactly.
Not close to an Ag Scepter. Jug can kind of scale well, but he's versing 2 to 3 core heroes when you look at what Slaughter, Ember, and Lifesteal. These are all pretty good late game forward.
Oh, an Eternal Levy not going to be quick enough on the fingers. Slithering Crush locks him down. Lifestealer takes him out. And now it's time for Wings to just enjoy the spoils of victory. They can back out, farm away. As you said, they've got very clearly the cores to be able to take late game with both Ember Spirit and Lifestealer. And we're talking about late game like it's something that we may actually see. But 20 minutes in, this is looking like a game that Wings is just going to roll over Secret and win by 30.
That's the thing. You get to 25 minutes in, what's currently a 7.5K goal, it gets to 10K. They're just going to look to keep on increasing this lead. And you're going to get to maybe 30 minutes in where you're ready to end the game because you've got 15K gold lead. You've kept finding more track kills. You continue to just farm your way to a first Roche and a second Roche. They can take Roche whenever they want. I think more than anything, they're just like, well, taking Roche is time where we could be pressuring Secret, taking towers, getting kills. So we're just going to wait a little bit and go for Roche later.
Yeah, and this is probably a big part of the reason why Wings were willing to blow smoke after smoke after smoke, right? They knew Secret had to be able to do well in that 15 to 20 minute marker, and if Wings actually rolled over in that period of time, well, there's not much Secret can really do. Eternal Envy isn't farmed enough that he's not gonna be a threat at 25 or 30 minutes without a battle fury picked up early. And they obviously have the late game to be able to fall back on as well as for Wings. So they throw everything into those periods of time, play ultra aggressive, get the pickoffs they need, and now gonna be able to look. Go all the more. Puppy's going to be the first target here. They managed to get a decent jump there from Arteezy, but it's just not enough. Now, bringing him back right into the Static Storm. He's able to get the jump away with the phase shift combination. Beautiful play from Arteezy. But again, is it really going to be enough? The Supernova way in the back line. And actually, Secret may have just lured Wings into a bad position with the Omnislash going down. They actually do get the Lifestealer. Oh, man. Secret punishing now as Arteezy's going to jump in for more, but a two-man crush. Oh no, Secret, are you the ones who went a little bit too far? Phase shift only going to last so long, and Arteezy is going to be left out to dry. Another track kill going the way of Wings, just as you think. Secret have a small opening to be able to get something back for themselves. They still feed away another track kill.
I guess Arteezy did have his blink completed. They're not done yet, though. Secret thinking about defending the tier one, but to act quickly if that's the case, and it doesn't look like they've got the tools to do so. All their ulties on cooldown, so they committed pretty much everything. They get a lifesteal, which is a high-value pickup, but Wings get an objective. They continue to have momentum in their favor as well, and with this T1 bottom tower down, taking Roshan now gets that much easier.
Blink Dagger for Ice Ice, a disruptor with a 22-minute Blink Dagger. That's definitely a scary thought.
And not your everyday disruptor item, but this item gets so much better because they've got the vision tools in Bounty Hunter and Slaughter with their ultimate. So being able to reposition and catch those here, get that little bit closer to get those glimpses off becomes that much more powerful.
Wings. Four man in mid, one at top. Ember's Spirit is free to pretty much do as he likes, just because Secret have been pushed back so far that it's unlikely for them to ever be able to get in an aggressive stance. They're going to be able to go for another smoke, wrap around behind the tier 2 at top, or maybe the tier 2 mid. The cut between the tier 3s.
The slot has picked up a Reva of all items. Second item Reva.
Jesus.
I've never seen anything like that. Perhaps Wings have done it before. But
if he gets a heart early, how do you even deal with that? Like, Secret actually may not have the damage to be able to pop that hero, which normally you can, right? Because Sprint amplifies that damage. You're relying on that utility. Oh no, it's her Levy. He thinks this is an opportunity to be able to farm the stack, but he's gone already. Can't even call it fast enough. The Ember Spirit now with the Battle Fury is going to be able to take that stack. And what little hope there was remaining for Secret, I think, just got extinguished with that stack.
That was a crazy good smoke from Wings. They got themselves in position where they could use the Observer Ward, scouting out the Ancients area. They bypassed the Secret vision around the Roshan pit, and they have a pretty good idea that Secret aren't going to... They knew Secret didn't have a ward on top of theirs with their sentry, so there's not going to be any vision over where that T1 bottom tower normally is.
Oh, crazy play here. Supernova going out of the side, but Arteezy does manage to get silenced up before he can do much there. Great Static Storm from Ice Ice, and now Pylai die. Refreshed up,
possible
does
blink
manage.
Glimpse.
Oh, he's got the glimpse. He's got it in play. Pylai Dai is going to be pulled back right into Ulfian as well as Blink.
That's almost like the game right there. They're not going to quite call it with the tier 2 tower still up, but that's that YOLO all in. Let's try and contest Roshan, and you just give them multiple track kills. You lose your mid puck, you lose Aegis, and Wings get even further ahead.
Yeah, you know if your Secret. You had to do something desperate, and that was definitely the desperate play, but This doesn't work out for them. The Blink Dagger now up for Blink. We saw that earlier. And he already has another 1,600 gold.
Interesting to see the pipe over the mech, but a very good item against the Puck who has built into the Veil. It's going to give some great just self-sustainability, but also, more importantly, the teamfight factor where his whole team can block a lot of that Puck damage output.
Yeah, and give them opportunities to push high ground a lot earlier. Being able to keep those creeps alive against the Veil spam.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct.
With the Desolator, they can actually challenge some of these Tier 2s and even Tier 3s rather early on, just considering how far ahead they really are. Looks like they may have found another one here on the left-hand side. We're going to see Eternal Envy. It's going to be Static Stormed immediately. Good combo. Ice, once again, showing off that Blink Dagger with the instant disables on some of these heroes that usually have some great defense mechanisms, the Puck as well as the Juggernaut, but the Disruptor that's this far ahead is punishing them.
Yeah, you think of a Jug kind of farming alone there, as long as he can blade through TP away, the one thing that could catch him by surprise is the Slaughter, who's not there, but Blink Static Storm also does the trick, and Wings now should find themselves a free Tier 2 tower up top. Really feel it's the time for Secret to fight right now. They're against an Aegis. High ground is going to be your best bet, but Wings, if you stay on your high ground, Wings can always just kind of play the slow roll game. Just maintain map control, deward the entire map, farm your jungle, farm their side of the map, farm your side of the map, and just get further and further ahead.
Yeah, what we're really going to see here in the next few minutes is more about Wings than anything else. It's going to be how patient and how disciplined they really want to be in this kind of match, where they very clearly have a gigantic lead, and they could potentially end the game right here in the next 5 minutes, but it does come at a small risk. Very small, but they could keep that risk even smaller if they just spend more time out farming Secret.
And every play Secret's making, it feels like a desperation play. The Roche contest, now they're going to go for a four-man smoke, sit behind Eternal Envy. It's kind of like these desperation smokes that you're just hoping gets yourself in a good position to take a team fight, but realistically, Wings aren't having any of this.
Maybe they can get the Ember Spirit, the Blink forward from Arteezy, leading with a silence. Could have caught out Blink. They may still inside the trees. No. Got out in time.
Close, and I believe Nighttime. Okay, so he will be coming back around the 28-minute mark, but it's Wings who are going to cut off the retreat.
They're going to be able to catch Secret now, running back downwards, maybe realizing that they're trapped on the enemy side of the base. Pylai Dai is going to be spotted out here, does have the dive, tries to get away, has track on himself. Just don't think that's going to happen, not with the Disruptor on the team. Another track kill for Wings.
Starting to add up. The gem is there for Wings, so they can take out all the vision of Team Secret. And it's just one out of tower off the other. So it seems like, I'm about to say mid lane, they've just dived the high ground. I was about to say, It seems like Wings are taking this slow, but no, they're ready to dive.
They take one, make it two, as Puppy's also going to go down. Arteezy can't really stop them with the Dream Coil. They glimpse back Arteezy, face shift, blink out, he'll be okay, but only for a few minutes, it seems, as Wings are just not going to give Secret any room. I mean, this is game number one. Maybe Wings going for a psychological play, trying to break their spirit as soon as possible in this series by ending the game outright.
The Slaughter with the Heart literally just blind blinked onto the high ground of a Tier 3 tower and found a crush. He's like, oh, sweet, that's a kill. I'll take it.
Yeah. With the Heart, you can make those kind of plays fearlessly, knowing Secrets just do not have the damage need for you fast enough. Lifestealer inside, they can't challenge you either. There goes the lane of Rax. Wings, happy with the pickoff. Start backing up. Phoenix, I think, hoping to be able to draw Wings back inside, as that's really the only way. Oh, Ice jumps in. Okay, not being able to get that kinetic field, forcing out the Supernova. And okay, now let's really call it a day. Wings will back themselves away. Double chain, never mind. Jump back in, Bian. Missing the crush. The pipe is going to be able to keep them protected a little bit. Secret.
It's strange because it keeps feeling like, okay, time to back off Wings. Yeah. Like, you just lost your Aegis, you just wasted
stuff. Oh, no, another two-man crush. They're just like, we're so far ahead, let's keep on going.
Yeah.
Underneath Tier 4 towers.
I mean, most of the time you waste Static Storm and Aegis, you have to back off, but as you said, too far ahead.
And now the jump in, two-man crush once again with the Lifestealer popping out already. Eternal Heavy's gone. No Omni Slash opportunities, that's it. Puppy's calling it. The leader says this is This is not good.
Classic Wings Gaming, a killer minute, aggression, aggression. They start off maybe a bit slower in the laning stage, but once they get going, boy, do they get going. And this is why, like, the Bounty Hunter is just one of those most banned heroes when you're versing Wings, because their mid game with Bounty is just scary.
I'm not sure what other way to really put it. Secret, an embarrassing defeat here in game number one in this best of three, maybe going out bottom of their group.
You can see it here. These guys are just not even talking. They're just like, what has happened today? 2-0 by Na'Vi. They had a close game one. Game two, not close at all. And this game, kind of similar. They just look completely flat. They don't look like the Team Secret of many months ago, that the Team Secret from the Shanghai Major that people have come to kind of expect out of this caliber of team.
All right. Well, fortunately, it was a very straightforward game. It'll make it a lot easier for our analysts who need every bit of help they could possibly get.
Yes, indeed. Thanks very much, Cap. I'll give them a fair chance to respond to that in a minute, but crazy first game from Wings. Hashtag just Wings things. I think that one's definitely a thing now. Fogged, I'm just going to let you impale yourself on your own prediction.
I really want to, because I even said it.
I think you deserve to.
I deserve it. I really do.
You do deserve it.
I said it right away. I was like, man, they have only spell damage, and there's a lifestealer. I'm going to go Secret.
You kind of talked yourself out of it, and then you just went with it. I was like, oh, okay, then, well, that seems weird, but all right, I'm not the expert.
I'll go ahead and take 85% of that blame, and I'll throw 50% on Toby for getting that idea of the Phoenix and his melee heroes tonight. So
you can throw a little bit on me, but 50%? Obviously it proves I've developed as an analyst, because I was able to change my opinion after I realized how things were going poorly.
Okay, Toby won.
You're really going to puff yourself up over that, huh,
expert
Toby?
Expert analysis.
Okay.
Seems good.
Seems good, indeed.
I need all the help I can get. Obviously,
well, Cap said.
Hey, Cap was saying, yeah, we did need a lot of help. I don't get it from him, though. I get it from Blitz.
All right.
Oh, boy.
Let's not go there right now, because that's
it.
Too early. That's
I deserve
early.
Anything that comes out.
This segment is about as ugly as that game. As you look at these graphs, this is just, it was domination from start to finish. I love these, by the way. These are dynamic GPM, XPM, and kill graphs, so you can see how the entire team grew and evolved over the course of the match.
Or didn't.
And you can just see how one-sided this was. I mean, saying that it ended at 28 minutes is just drastically understating the case.
It kind of ended at 12 minutes, aka when Slaughter picked up his blink dagger.
Yeah,
like that had to be one of the critical moments for him. Like at that point, and you actually took a team which didn't actually have any real straight initiation. They only had like counter initiation from the disruptor, and you gave them the ability to then walk all over him. Like Jackie Malco get absolutely nothing done, and he was forced into fights he never wanted to take.
But just look at that last one, that the gold distribution across all five wings. It's just like a perfect fan almost. They're getting farmed just because of the new AoE gold dynamics, where they're winning fights and they're getting farm on all their heroes. The supports are actually getting a little bit more gold from those assists than they would have because of the redistribution based on net worth rankings. They're able to just get those items up on their entire team. You saw the early hood, the early pipe up on the Bounty Hunter, those support items, so that all five of their heroes are able to contribute in every engagement.
Yep. Let's take a look back at some of the highlights. And if you're a Wings fan, these are great, but if you're a Secret fan, even this opening one is pretty disgusting.
The Bounty Hunter's positioning in this fight is absolutely perfect. He just wraps up from behind. He's got the infested lifestealer, and here we go. Eggs out, but guess what? There's a lifestealer right there with a Bounty Hunter.
The crazy thing is, too, they didn't even set up for this. Like, they may have read the fact that Secret were moving, but originally, Bounty Hunter was looking to do what he was doing before. Like, they moved in with an infest movement to kill off Puppy when he was inside the Dire Jungle only a couple of minutes before this. And then they combine again. The second you get infest off cooldown, they move over towards Roshan, towards the Dire range, just thinking maybe Secret are farming that. Nope, they come down and they get an entire team wipe, not to mention a huge injection of money into that lifestealer.
Yeah, I mean, from here on in, I mean, I think, Fog, you were saying, it's interesting, it looks like Secret have kind of built an early game lineup here.
Yep.
Where was it?
Just, I guess, like you guys were saying too before, the Phoenix just wasn't really the best support to be able to do that, and you could see how heavily got punished, because Slaughter got what? It was a pre-11 minute blink dagger.
It was 12:20.
Oh, it was 12:20? 12:20 minute blink dagger, so it solves all their problems. Having that Blink Dagger, and then they get the level 6 on Bounty Hunter, and then, yeah, you basically got everything you need to fight constantly, and Secret just can't.
I still can't believe, too, like, you get your initiation, then you just build into this point where Secret can't do jack. Like, it was, what, a 30-minute hard as well over onto that Slaughter?
Maybe earlier.
They just outlasted them. Like, you have a Bounty who's like, I don't need to get Greaves. I don't need to get a mech. My team is living anyway, so pipe.
I have to ask you this, Fog, because I mean you watch this with me, you're watching these highlights as I'm watching them. Is Secret talking at all during these fights? Because I was looking at their replays from Epicenter before this tournament, and it just looked like they were not communicating at all during a lot of these team engagements.
Maybe they have to have something going on with their synergy. Something has to be happening because they look kind of like all over the place.
Yeah,
like,
there are five different players going for five different objectives in the middle of a lot of these fights.
I can't just say that Secret's not communicating because also Wings is playing like that game was pretty perfect by them. Their movement,
sure.
They were predicting the movements. They were getting exactly what they needed for the fights, and then they knew exactly what Secret was going to do basically.
Yep. I'm still wondering if that Juggernaut pick was the right one. And I was saying that before, and you guys were a little bit iffy about it. But I still feel like Team Secret with that Juggernaut pick, it didn't do enough early on.
And the
Ember Spirit was able to get involved. Like, he just, like, Flame Guard, I got Syrian Chains. I can do stuff with the supports who are in my lane. I glimpse back into Syrian Chains. I can do something there. Then you get yourself a Juggernaut, and the first thing Juggernaut was involved in was, I can help farm up some Ancients, which by that point, Wings were already initiating on you and forcing a fight, which then he could not win.
At the end of the day, though, was there a right pick? That's the question. I think you had drafted yourself into a corner by that point. At that point, there was only one hero left when you picked the Juggernaut, and you picked a hero that's very strong at a point in the game that you thought you could win. Juggernaut had been, I think, 33-21 mm-hmm. before this game in this patch in 20 to 40-minute matches. He's a very strong mid-gamer. But at that point, you already had a 4 magic damage hero based lineup against the Lifestealer, as we've been talking about the whole time. I don't know that there was a hero at that point that could have saved Secret's draft.
Mm. Yeah. Well, poor draft. I think we'd agree with that. Let's also talk about the other draft, which was the Wings draft. Like, we don't even need to ban everyone. Like, what's that all about? Is that just is that the ultra confident Wings coming up? Was it a mistake?
They probably ran it, just didn't notice their time.
I mean,
or they're just mind game professionals. Yeah. Like, that always tells people, it's like, what? They gave me the black square.
Yeah.
How dare you?
It's your hashtag.
If you go like full pirate now, it's the black spot.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know what to say. I mean, it just seems ridiculous that they would just not ban it. Like, guys, we've got this anyway. We know what we're going to pick. We're going to pick Disruptor last anyway. They can't do anything about it.
It may not
even. You've already said they couldn't have picked anything else.
It just probably didn't matter to them. It's like, you know what? Like, what do we care about? What we ban? No, we don't.
Yeah.
All our attention should be focused on what rounds up our lineup. The whole, we just don't care what Team Secret pick, because no matter what they pick as the last one, as Nahal says, you couldn't win. I actually like that fourth block pick of Ember as well. I'm still sitting on it. Just like, they had to be like, okay, this hurts. Mm.
Look, what makes Wings, I think what makes Wings unusual is part of what makes them so strong, and that's that they, when they're drafting, I really do believe they think more about the style of Dota that they like to play than they think about the particular heroes that they're playing it with. They say, we're going to pick 5 heroes and we're going to run at you, and it is up to you to deal with that, and you can counterpick us all you want. We're still going to play our game. And it is completely, the pressure is completely on the other team to deal with that and to take them out of that play style.
We spoke a little bit earlier on when you were on the panel about the differences coaches can make. And we argued that Wings might come a cropper here in a way because they don't have a coach. Mm-hmm. They're very gung-ho. Alan's already said they just march in and try and run at you. And for the teams that are playing with the coaches, you'd expect them to be able to counter that better.
Yeah, I'm not really too sure. Like, especially Theban. Like, we know he is one of the best coaches.
Yeah.
Absolutely, you cannot say against that. And it just doesn't seem like it. Just maybe they're not clicking, maybe they're not listening to him properly, but there has to be some sort of like something going on between them. Like, I'm not too sure what's happening.
It also depends how heavy the coach gets involved, because if the coach is there and he's just like, okay, you know, you should be playing this way, you should be timing that way, sometimes the coaches don't do that. They're more of a, you know what, I have this concept. Like, that's one of like 1437's greatest attributes, is the fact that he sees the game in a way that a lot of other people do not. And he'll give you that little edge against up against one team, or help you kind of craft something to be stronger for yourself. Like, instead of actually saying like in-game communication should be this way, that was one big thing with Fnatic at the Shanghai Major, where we saw their coach actually impact that a lot. He gave purpose to their movement, to the way they play and the way they draft.
Yeah, but Theban has one of the best minds in Dota, so maybe, you know, maybe it's maybe it is the communication thing, like you were saying. It has to be something like this because
you watch these fights and they're just, you know, I watched probably their game against Virtus Pro from Epicenter where they fed an 0-5 team kill and then they fed G's Ember Spirit a Rampage like 7 minutes later. I watched that replay like 10 different times just trying to figure out what was their approach. What were they doing during these fights? Like, how were they trying to move relative to each other to give them a chance to win? And I just couldn't figure out, like, what's the logic behind? I think there are some serious, serious issues in terms of the way they're executing here, which is probably the understatement of the century.
Are you surprised that we're still seeing it? I mean, I know it's only a couple of weeks on from Epicenter, but Puppy's come out in the meantime and said, you know, actually, we know we need to work on the team chemistry. He's joked a little bit about it between Arteezy and EE as well. But he's been very blunt about the fact that he knows they have to work on the chemistry. Is 2 weeks too short a period? Or would you have expected to have seen some improvement here?
It depends how open the players are to also the feedback. Like, you can give them all the feedback they want, but if they're just like, no, I'm doing my job right. Like, we don't know, like, what's happening inside that camp.
I mean, surely they're going to listen to him.
Well, at the same time, Puppy had that same problem with the old Na'Vi. Like, because he basically went to Terra Gravity and said, things will happen my way or they leave the team. That was actually it. That's exactly what happened. He basically declared martial law. And I don't know if that's really possible, if he really wants to do that with the players he's got, because like players like Arteezy, you won't actually give them freedom to do whatever they want because
he knows that, surely.
Yeah,
he's a smart guy. He knows he's got to give him that freedom.
Yeah, but it's then having like five free people working perfectly together. Mm. And that's very difficult to get. Like, that you have to try and build that kind of synergy.
So let's just take a look at them right now. They are over in their tournament room right now. Just to try and gauge what we can see from body language. I mean,
they were looking a bit flustered.
Yeah. A little bit, I felt. So, always difficult to read, actually.
Thiepen was in the back room, though. I was like wondering like who Thiepen would be talking to. And just sitting there on the back, it's just like, you know what, just take one player out. Mm. Not everyone, and like do that. Like, Puppy's still there, but they're not talking to each other in between the game.
That's really disturbing.
That's really, yeah.
And look, the entire time that you were saying that, Toby, I was thinking, I think there's something to what you're saying, but at the same time, we've seen this from Puppy before. We have seen last summer, Secret failed to reach top four in four straight lands, then won four straight major events. Before Shanghai, Secret failed to reach top four in four straight lands, came into Shanghai, won the whole thing. We've seen Puppy turn teams around. We've seen him do it on a very short timetable before. I really expected it was going to happen. I mean, I had them at least top eight at this event.
Hmm.
I'm not sure everyone had them talking.
No.
They were quite.